Welcome, and thank you for joining us for Beyond the Data. I'm Dr. Phoebe Thorpe, here today with Dr. John Ward, the Director of the Division of Viral Hepatitis at CDC. Thank you very much for joining us, John.
It's nice to be here, Phoebe.
Great. Today, we learned that there is a cure for hepatitis C, and it sounds like it's safer and easier and cures more people. What can you tell me about it?
Well, we've had a cure for hepatitis C for many years, but what's the good news is that we've had a big breakthrough in the effectiveness of these drugs, and at the same time, they have become safer and easier to take as patients.
So, as a healthcare provider, what could I do to help my patients who might have hepatitis C?
First thing you can do is test the patients who are at high risk for this infection. Of the 3 million people infected with hepatitis C in the United States, about three out of every four of those are the so-called baby boom generation, persons born between 1945 and 1965.
Why is it so concentrated in that period?
Three of every four persons who have hepatitis C were born between 1945 and 1965. Of all persons born between 1945 and 1965, about 3% have been infected with hepatitis C, which is quite a high prevalence for a viral infection that can lead to liver cancer and premature mortality.
What do they need to do to get tested or screened?
Most people have a regular physician, mm-hmm. and when they go in to see their clinician, the next time they should ask for a test for hepatitis C.
What does the testing involve?
So it is a blood test. There's a rapid point of care test that only requires a finger stick. It takes about 20 minutes to get a result back.
And then is there more testing beyond just that rapid test?
So the first test tells you whether you've been exposed or not by detecting the antibody mm-hmm. that the body produces when it comes in contact with an infectious disease like hepatitis C virus. And then once infected, a person has about a 70% likelihood of remaining infected for life unless they get treated. This isn't a static problem, it's a dynamic problem, meaning new infections continue to occur.
You know, sure.
So
sure.
CDC is we have two goals for prevention. We want to stop mortality from this virus, and we want to stop new infections. And unfortunately, new infections are rising in the United States.
What are the risks there that are making the number of people exposed to hepatitis C go up?
That's exactly right. In the 90s, the blood supply became very safe through testing. Healthcare settings became safer through various interventions mm-hmm. for patient safety. Mm-hmm. And even among injection drug users, the transmission risk went down in response to the HIV epidemic. But just in the last 3 to 4 years, we've seen a dramatic increase in the number of new cases of hepatitis C. And indeed, in the nation, about a 50% increase. And some states are reporting a 200% increase in the number of new cases.
And so, those are related to what?
So that's strongly and heavily related to a reemergence of injection drug use.
Is there guidelines now if you are a person who inject drugs and can't seem to kick the habit? Are there guidelines for how often you should be tested for hepatitis C?
We recommend everybody get tested if they're drug users. That's sort of the first order of business, and that's not done as well as we would like. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of injection drug users who still are unaware of their status one way or the other. But because they're high risk, we think they should be screened about every year. Now we have to learn how to use these new treatments that are so safe, highly effective, and shorter acting than the other medications in the past.
So half the length, and no having to go into the doctor to get an IV put in and have the medication put in an IV
right.
form. Okay.
Right. And the new research suggests that the treatment duration might be able to be reduced to 8 weeks.
The treatments were more complicated before, but now that they're easier and they also kind of sound like they're working better.
We need to really, you know, correct those old impressions of, mm-hmm. of treatment, because we've entered into a new era mm-hmm. of these, that a lot of these barriers that you just highlighted of side effects and duration of treatment are going away. And so those barriers are dropping. And it's really coming at a very, very important time for public health, because we want to reverse these increases in death, avert premature death. We feel like we can save 120,000 lives if we fully implement the birth cohort strategy at least.
Wow. Some of the things that came up today also were cost.
And that's, you know, often the case when you have these breakthroughs in medicine mm-hmm. and these sort of first-in-class agents in a particular category, they tend to be expensive. I mean, this is the first cure of a chronic viral infection in the history of medicine. And so it's a mm-hmm. it's a monumental mm-hmm. event.
A cure.
It's so
nice to be able to say that word.
It does.
It's a cure.
I agree. We have to get used to saying it.
Yeah.
But we still have to deal with the cost issue. Mm-hmm. As a country, CDC, as an agency, doesn't have a role in drug pricing or anything like that. But mm-hmm. What we try to do is look at data, examine the cost effectiveness of various interventions. And what our data tell us is that if someone is HCV infected and has liver disease, it's very cost effective for the country to treat that person, clear their infection, and lower their risk of cancer by 70% and their risk of mortality by 50%. And in so doing, you're saving the cost to the health system of caring for those diseases down the road.
Okay.
Yeah. And improve that individual's quality
exactly.
of life.
Exactly, and that's all a public health perspective.
That's right. There's a public health
And in the meantime, the person gets to be healthier and live longer.
Right. We don't want to lose sight of the benefits of
yes.
treatment. We
mm-hmm.
want to always bring those together and mm-hmm. examine them together. And so I think that's what the role that CDC can play.
If they're cured, they're not going to be able to transmit it to other people.
Absolutely, and yeah. I think that hasn't really been brought into the equation.
Mm-hmm. But it interrupts yet. Transmission.
They can interrupt transmission, mm-hmm. so you're saving additional cost mm-hmm. in that way, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much for joining us.
I enjoyed it.
Yeah. And thank you very much for joining us for Beyond the Data. We'll see you next month. Thank you.